afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the Aquarium of the Pacific for another episode of the Aquarium's Online Academy. This episode is all about seals, sea lions, and their conservation. So we're going to be learning a lot about the seals and sea lions that live here at the aquarium, about seals and sea lions in general, and also about the challenges facing them in the modern world. What's it like for them outside in our coastal oceans where they all live? What's it like in the ocean farther out where they go hunting for food and so on? How are they thriving or not thriving in the face of just the way the world is today with all the human activity that goes on? So throughout this program, as we learn all sorts of cool things about seals and sea lions, just like with all of our other online academy programs, you're welcome to text into us. Remember, texting rates from your carrier may apply, but if you want to text us, you can do so. We have James monitoring our text stream right now, and you can send us any of your questions throughout the program. So if you're curious about anything I'm talking about, or frankly, something I'm not even talking about, and maybe you just want to hear more about, feel free to ask, and James will pass a lot of those questions on to me. Now, sometimes we do get so many questions that we can't answer them all here on the program, but I promise you we will respond to every single one in text, and we'll try to answer just as many as we can on the program here live. Also, if you're watching this program post facto, you can email us questions. You can email us at live@lbaop.org. So if you're watching this at a later date and we're not live at the moment, you can send an email to that address and we'll be happy to take your questions there. So let's start by thinking a little bit about seals and sea lions. Dana, who is operating all of our video up behind me here, is going to bring up some images of, well, let's see, maybe a seal, maybe a sea lion. I don't know. Dana, what do we got? Ooh, so what animal is this? Let's see, one of the first things about seals and sea lions that confuses people as well, they're confused about which ones are seals and which ones are sea lions, right? And oftentimes when people look at this animal, their first instinct is to say that they're seals. But that's a misconception. Most of the time, actually, when it's kind of funny, actually, most of the time when people do point at an animal they think is a seal and say it's a seal, they're actually pointing at a sea lion. Because sea lions are much more agile on land. You're more likely to come across them on things like docks and piers and rocks. Seals are a little bit more reclusive, don't like to hang around close to people quite as often, and also aren't nearly as agile on land. You notice how this sea lion is, this is probably Parker when he was younger, he lives here at the aquarium. You notice how he's got himself propped up on his front flippers and got his back flippers kind of rolled underneath himself? One of the big differences between seals and sea lions is that sea lions, like Parker here, can walk on land using all fours. If you compare this to a seal, which we'll do in a few minutes, they kind of have to pull themselves along, kind of doing the worm. There's actually a word for it called, we call it galumphing. It's a word that I think some of you might have heard before in school, if you ever read the poem Jabberwocky. But anyway, we also use that word to describe the movement of seals on land, this sort of like worm-like motion they just kind of pull themselves along with. So that's one of the big differences between seals and sea lions. And here's a picture of a harbor seal here. You can see this animal, if it were to go on land, would have a much harder time pulling itself along because, for one thing, this back hip here that the back flippers are attached to can't rotate under its body in the same way that a sea lion's can. And also, those front flippers aren't nearly as long, and they just don't have the ability to push themselves up, or at least most seals don't. There are some seals, such as the elephant seals that we'll talk about in a little bit, who do have that ability. But let's go real quickly through all the differences between seals and sea lions, or at least the easy ones, so we always can remember them and never get confused about it again. So, for one thing, if you're looking at a seal, such as this harbor seal here, like I said, harbor seals don't have the ability to walk on land, so that's one thing. Secondly, if you're looking at a seal, another big tip-off, if you're looking at a true seal, the easiest way to tell, even if you just see their head sticking out of the water, is that seals don't have an external ear flap. Instead, they just have a hole on the side of their head. They can still hear, but their hearing is more specialized for underwater situations, so they've done away with their external ear flap over time. Makes them a little more streamlined in the water. And that way, you should always be able to tell whether you're looking at a sea lion's head or a seal's head. So if we look at our sea lion here, California sea lion Parker, you can see he's got a little ear flap there. And then another difference that we always cite at the aquarium is that sea lions are very noisy compared to seals. Seals do make noises sometimes. They make little kind of honky, snorty noises and stuff like that. But it's nothing like the ar sound that you hear coming out of a sea lion. That sound we call a bark. So the way I always remember what the difference is between seals and sea lions is I try to think about sea lions and kind of compare them to the animal they're named after on land. Lions. I go, okay, well, lions, they've got ear flaps, right? So do sea lions. Lions can walk around on all fours. So can sea lions. And also, of course, sea lions, just like lions, can be pretty loud. They can make loud noises. In the case of the lion, it's the roar. In the case of the sea lion, it's a bark, but still, loud noises, right? The seals, on the other hand, mild-mannered by comparison, can't walk around on all fours, don't have those ear flaps, so there's not very many things about them that make you kind of think of a lion. But the funny part is, though, even though their names, you know, are, even though the sea lion is named after a sea lion, aside from these coincidental similarities, is no closer to being a lion than a seal is. And that's because seals and sea lions are part of the same family of marine mammals. The family that they belong to is called the pinnipeds, which just means fin-footed or feather-footed animals. So they are marine, they are mammals like lions are, but they're from a totally different group. You know, lions are kind of cat. Seals and sea lions are part of this group called the pinnipeds. And the pinnipeds include not just seals and sea lions, but also a third group of animals, which we don't have here at the aquarium, but I bet you've heard of before. It also includes walruses, which are, I have to say, maybe my favorite of all the pinnipeds, or maybe elephant seals. I don't know. It's a tough one. So those three different kinds of marine mammals, again, seals, sea lions, and walruses, are all part of the pinniped family. And they all have a lot of things in common because they all share the same evolutionary background. They all descended from some common ancestor that went into the ocean and then gradually evolved and developed to branch off into these three different groups of animals. And they've also managed to thrive in almost all the parts of the world ocean, at least along coastal regions. Yeah, it's true, you don't see sea lions or seals in the middle of the ocean very much, though a few of them will sometimes go really far out to forage. But you do see them in coastlines from tropical places all the way to the coldest parts of the ocean. You've got leopard seals down in Antarctica. You've got things like fur seals in Alaska and stuff like that. So there are seals in basically all the coastlines of the world, either have seals now or have had seals at some point in their history. And I should say seals, sea lions, or walruses, some member of the pinniped family. Now, again, if you want to ask us any questions during this program, you can text them at 562-286-1838. 562-286-1838. And now let's talk a little bit about how seals and sea lions survive out in the natural habitat. I think we actually have a video of some sea lions out in the natural habitat. Let's see what they do. So watch this. I'm going to step out of the view here for a second. So you can see this is a whole bunch of sea lions. It looks like these are all females and juveniles. You can usually identify a male sea lion by looking for a big bump on the top of their head called a sagittal crest. And they only get them when they're adults. So these are all probably female sea lions and maybe younger sea lions. Now, watch what they're doing here. They're looking around for something to eat. They're also interacting with each other quite a lot. And this is just one of the ways that they hunt. Sea lions can be found off our coast, both foraging in kelp forests, kind of looking for fish they can scare out of nooks and crannies to kind of to grab. And they can also be found oftentimes hunting in somewhat more open water. Now, they don't go, like I said, they don't go way out into the ocean thousands of miles out like some animals can, but they do oftentimes go several miles out from shore looking for things like schools of sardines and stuff to chase around. And they oftentimes work together. If you look at all these sea lions, if these sea lions were to come across a big school of fish, they would probably start surrounding it, chasing it, trying to tighten it up into a ball until eventually they were able to go in and start grabbing different fish from it. Now, harbor seals and many other seals eat in a somewhat different way. If you look at a harbor seal, and we can bring probably another picture of a harbor seal or any kind of seal actually up here. Harbor seals and a lot of other seals don't quite chase things down like sea lions do. Harbor seals have a body that's a little bit more well adapted to more foraging on the bottom. So what this harbor seal does is it moves along the bottom, kind of browses along the bottom looking for anything that it can see. You know, maybe shellfish and things like that hiding in the sand. And it has these flippers in the back here that actually move in a pretty different way from sea lions. So sea lions propel themselves. They push with their front flippers. Harbor seals and all the other seals propel themselves. Ooh, do we have a video? Propel themselves with a paddle-like motion of their back flippers. So you notice those side flippers are kind of just being used to steer. And as this seal turns, watch those flippers. Of course, it doesn't move them now that I'm talking about it, but there we go. Here you can see it here. So you see that paddle-like motion, that back and forth? It's almost fish-like, right? And that's just a product of the different way that they ended up adapting their limbs to move in the water. So harbor seals move through the kelp forest more. They do more foraging on the bottom. They will eat fish if they can get it. But a lot of the time, they'll eat stuff along the bottom, as you can see this seal doing here. And because the harbor seals and sea lions have very different ways of hunting, this means that they can tend to live in the same environments without really having much conflict with each other. Also, you notice that the harbor seals have these little, almost like claws on their front flippers. Those are present in the sea lions, but they're very, 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 I guess, vestigial is the technical term. They don't really use them for much of anything. They're kind of leftover. And harbor seals, those claws actually still have a little bit of a purpose to help them climb under rocks and stuff like that. It looks like we've gotten our first questions of the day. How many types of seals and sea lions are there? That's a very good question. Sea lions are actually the less diverse of the group. There's only about 8 different kinds of sea lions in the world, whereas seals, there's about 20. And seals, it's a little complex, but as with any animal, you know, sometimes we talk about different species. There can be some debate among scientists as to whether an animal should be divided into different subspecies or different species. So, for example, there's a number of different varieties of seals called monk seals. One of them, the Caribbean monk seal, is extinct. On the other hand, the Hawaiian monk seal is endangered, but they're called monk seals because they're actually related to each other. They're similar. And likewise, there's some sea lions that if you were to look at them, you'd think that was a California sea lion, but technically it's not. Or there's also the Steller sea lion that we get here in California sometimes that will actually sometimes hang out with California sea lions, even though the Steller, and it looks very similar, except the Steller sea lion is like 4 or 5 times as big. So, oh, and here's a monk seal. We got a monk seal. Hello, monk seal. So this footage is, I think, courtesy of NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. Oh, look at that. Isn't that precious? Get a good view of the teeth there, by the way. And this is another behavior, by the way, that you see from seals and sea lions a lot. In between all those hunts they do, they don't just stay in the water all the time. A lot of them are members of the pinniped family, including harbor seals, including California sea lions, really can only stay in the water for so long before they start to get too cold and have to come out. Now, there are some members of the seal family that can stay in the water for a really long time. Elephant seals are a great example of this. But elephant seals can do that because they're huge. And when you're really, really, really big, it makes it a lot easier to hold on to your body heat. So generally, the bigger a mammal gets in the ocean, the better a time it's going to have handling colder water. Now, we got another question as well. What do sea lions normally eat, and what do our sea lions normally eat? Like I said, sea lions are mainly hunting fish and squid. So they find schools of those things, they chase them around. Sometimes they try to knock about in the kelp forest, trying to see if they can sear things out into the open. Here at the aquarium, we feed them pretty much the same type of stuff. Our sea lions have big appetites. They consume about 5 to 8% of their body weight in food every day. So that adds up to, I don't know, what, a dozen pounds, 20 pounds? Yeah, 10 to 20 pounds of food, depending on how big the animals you're talking about. And and we give them the same kind of stuff, and actually a lot of the same species of stuff. There's a type of squid off our coast called market squid. That's the kind we feed and that's the kind they eat out in the ocean. That's also the kind we feed them here. We feed our animals things like our sea lions things like sardines and so on, another thing they'd eat in the natural habitat. So it's pretty much the same food they'd eat in nature. Another good question, where did seals and sea lions originate? Oh, that's a good one. So this goes back way into the ancient history of the ocean. So y'all know, right, that 65, or I guess they're saying now 66 million years ago, there was a big catastrophe. Most people think an asteroid hit the Earth and the dinosaurs all disappeared, right? Or virtually all the dinosaurs except for the birds. Well, after that happened, and all these big predators were gone, mammals, which had up to that point been relatively small, started to kind of evolve and take up some of these new places that had been freed after the Earth recovered from the disaster. And all these new habitats formed and all these new animals developed. And about 50 million years ago, there was an animal moving around that probably looked kind of like, and we know a lot of this from the fossil record, there was an animal moving around that probably looked a little bit like a blend between a dog and a cat and a bear and stuff like that. That animal was the common ancestor of a whole bunch of animals that live today, including things, again, like dogs and cats and bears, and also the pinnipeds, which split off from that family 50 or so million years ago. So it used to be that there was some land-dwelling animal that moved around on all four legs, and this animal was sort of dog, cat-like. And eventually, it had descendants that moved into all these different kinds of habitats, some of which, many of which are still on land, and those descendants include dogs and cats and bears today. Also things like mustelids, so things like the family that, again, like otters are part of. But then this other branch went into the ocean, became the pinnipeds, this group that has some ancestral similarities to that original animal from way back long ago, but they managed to start living entirely in the ocean. And they're very well adapted to living in the ocean. Sea otters, by comparison, which are another member of that, which are also descended from that same ancient ancestor, sea otters entered the ocean a lot later. So this is one of the reasons why a lot of their adaptations are still much more similar to the kinds of things that an animal depends on land. When animals have been evolving when mammals evolve in the ocean for a really long time, they pretty much all develop blubber. But sea otters have never reached a point where evolution has pushed them to move away from fur. Sea otters still make do with fur to keep themselves warm. But now I'm getting off topic. I just love talking about that so much. So we said we were also going to today talk about the conservation of seals and sea lions, and that's a very, very worthwhile topic, because when we talk about big ocean animals like this, you know, we're really not just talking about the conservation of them. If we want to conserve big animals, big predators, we also have to conserve the habitats that support them. And let's actually get some really big animals up here. Can we get some, like, elephant seals up behind us, perhaps? So if you've got, say, a really big pinniped, like an elephant seal, that animal has to eat a big amount of food, right? And they only get so many nutrients from that food. So there has to be way, way, way more animals out there for them to eat in order for them to exist. So if there's, you know, 10,000 elephant seals hanging out in a part of the ocean, there has to be probably millions of animals in the ocean available for them to feed on. And if there are those animals underneath them on the food chain aren't available, then the elephant seals won't be able to survive. So let's say that elephant seals were having a problem. Elephant seals are doing okay, but there's other seals and sea lions that are. There's other members of the seal and sea lion family that aren't. Like I mentioned, the monk seals, right? If those animals are having a problem, in order to make them get healthier again, we really have to think about, okay, why are they having this challenge? Why are they having a hard time surviving? Why are their numbers dropping? And oftentimes the answer to that is because there's something wrong with their habitat. So by looking at big giant animals like our good friend the elephant seal here, we can then go, okay, what are the challenges those animals face and how can we make the environment healthier so that those animals are able to thrive more? And along the way, because we're protecting that big top predator and figuring out how to do it, we're also protecting so many species underneath them on the food chain. And by the way, look at these elephant seals. Now, I mentioned elephant seals can spend massive amounts of time in the ocean, right? They actually have an incredible migration. They go thousands of miles out into the ocean during their feeding migrations every year. But when they're not doing that, they come back to the beach and they just hang around in these massive groups. Sometimes they even pile on top of each other, which you can see a little bit of this going on there. And they do this instinctively, right? They can't help themselves. This is just what they do. But what cracks me up about it is they don't really look like they're having a great time, do they? And I don't say this as a scientific observation. I mean, just look at it. I mean, they're throwing sand on each other and barking at each other, and they just generally look really uncomfortable. But apparently this works for them because they keep on doing it. And by the way, this isn't a matter of them being too crowded onto specific beaches. There's plenty of beach space available. They don't have to pile up like this, but they do. And I've always found that pretty entertaining. Look at them go. It looks like a younger male there. You can tell them by their big floppy noses. Males like to have their own territory on a beach, so they tend to boss each other around. These guys are probably going to have a bit of a go at it in a moment, try to see who's boss at that section of the beach. And the female elephant seal is just like, whatever, just do your thing. Leave us alone. Now, we've got some more questions. What is the most popular seal? Ooh, I'm going to guess what is the one with the biggest population? I don't know. That's a really good question. I'm going to pass that back to James, who's monitoring the text feed. Can we find out what the most, oh, he already wrote it down for me. Most prevalent is probably the harbor seal. So that's the one we have here at the aquarium. And again, they're prevalent, but they're not as easy to find as some of their other local cousins. You see harbor seals here in Long Beach occasionally. If you know where to look, they're not hard to find, but sea lions we see all over the place. But nonetheless, like we were saying earlier, though, there are a lot more species of seals than there are sea lions. So that adds to the fact that any one species isn't going to have quite so much of a dominance probably. Now, here's another good question. How long can they hold their breath? Ooh, that's a good one. So harbor seals are far better at holding their breath than the California sea lions we have here at the aquarium. Our sea lions generally only dive for a couple minutes at a time. At the longest, they can dive for 10 minutes, if I'm not mistaken, at the maximum. But that's very rare for them to actually hold their breath that long. Harbor seals, on the other hand, can hold their breath for about half an hour if they want to. Now, they don't usually hold it that long either. But they don't have a big problem with holding their breath for a long time as long as they know they'll be able to go back up to the surface. And they're so comfortable with holding their breath underwater, in fact, that harbor seals can actually often be seen taking naps under the water. Here in our aquarium, sometimes people will walk by the window and they'll see our harbor seal just lying on the bottom. They'll say, oh my gosh, there must be something wrong with that harbor seal. But she's actually just taking a nap. And what was that question? I don't think I got to that one yet. What changes should we make to benefit seals and sea lions? This is another really great question. So when we return to that question of conservation, right? The big thing that challenges seals and sea lions today, because they're not hunted directly in our country, at least anymore, and it's very rare for them to be hunted in other parts of the world. But the big pressures on them these days are really the changing of their habitats and the loss of food. And really this just comes down to how much of their food we eat and also how much we do that might damage how their habitats work. So there's a couple different ways this can work. For one thing, let's say we're just going out there and catching all the same fish that seals and sea lions want to eat. Well, if we're doing that, then, and I haven't gotten to Oliver, I'm going to get to your question in just a moment. If we're doing that and we're eating all the food that they'd normally eat, then there's not going to be as much food available for them. So their populations are going to go down. Also, if, let's say, we have local seals and sea lions that live in the kelp forest, right? If we do things to our coast that maybe make the kelp forest less healthy, like let's say we raise the temperature of our coast due to climate change, which is happening, or we pollute our coast because of things like fertilizers and other kinds and chemical runoff and stuff like that going into the ocean and making the water less healthy, that can damage the habitat. And some of that stuff can also sometimes be toxic to seals and sea lions. But the good news here is that there's actually a lot of ways to help them. Even though we live, oh, look at the baby. Look at this. Isn't that precious? So the good news is there's a lot of ways to help them. If you live on land, just by thinking more carefully about the kinds of food choices you're making, you can help seals and sea lions. And I don't mean that you can't eat seafood, by the way. You just want to look to eat sustainable seafood. Try to learn about where your seafood comes from, whether or not it's from a species that really shouldn't be fished out of the ocean. Is it something that we can safely fish without depleting the natural habitat? And then when we're on land, just make sure that we do everything we can to keep our rivers and everything like that clean so that we're not pouring all of our waste into the ocean. So there's lots of ways we can help them. Oliver had a great question. What kind of teeth do they have? You know what, Oliver? I'm going to show you what kind of teeth they have. Let's go over to our side camera here, and we can look at the different teeth of seals and sea lions on the camera over here on the side. So I'm going to bring in a couple of skulls here, and the camera's way zoomed in. Let's see how far out we can go. Now, the sea lion skull is so big it barely even fits. Let's see if I can adjust our lighting a touch. Let's see here. Yeah, that sort of helps. So we'll start with the sea lion skull. Let's see here. So this big thing here is a sea lion skull. If I turn it on its side, you can kind of see the teeth there. So you can see these are pretty pointy teeth. And these teeth are really good for grabbing on to things like fish. Also, they're used in competition between the sea lions themselves sometimes. And those pointy teeth are really not for chewing. They're just for grabbing, gripping, and then swallowing the prey whole. Though occasionally there will be times when sea lions will kind of rip up their food before eating it, if they catch like a small shark or something like that. Now, on the other hand, and by the way, you can see one of the big indicators that they're related to animals like dogs and cats and bears on land. That family, they all have these very, very impressive canine teeth. That's one of the big indicators. And then there's a lot of other things about the shape of the skull, too, that show that. Now, in fact, if you look at a dog's teeth, actually, they're pretty similar in general, aren't they? But if we look at a seal's skull, we'll see a lot of similarities because they are, again, these guys, seals and sea lions are, again, close cousins. But this harbor seal skull is smaller. And the teeth, if we get a little closer to them, I can zoom in, I guess, are not quite as pointy. They're pointy, but the front teeth are smaller. And then these teeth in the back, it's a little hard to see here on the camera, but they have all these kind of ridges and bumps. These teeth are pointy, and that's good for gripping and slippery stuff, but also they're a little bit more effective at crunching shells and stuff like that, too. So this allows the harbor seal to be a little bit better at going after food that might be things like shellfish and stuff on the bottom. Like I said, the sea lion really just focuses on feeding on basically fish and squid. Very good question, Oliver. And we got a couple more questions, it looks like. We've got, oh yeah, how do they find their food? This is another good one. Every animal in the ocean, right, has to find its food using its senses. But different animals have different senses they use. Seals and sea lions very largely hunt through smell, sound, and sight. They tend to be daytime hunters. But there are some exceptions to that rule. Elephant seals, for example, can dive deep down into parts of the ocean that are so deep that there's barely any light there, and maybe no light at all. So at that point, they're not using sight to hunt for food. And the hard part for us, though, is then how do we observe what they're doing down there? We know elephant seals take really deep dives because we've come up with ways to measure how deep down they go. But it's really hard to watch what they do at the bottom of the ocean. But we can guess that they're probably using sound. They're probably using some amount of sense of movement because those whiskers on their face are really sensitive to movement. And also, there's a small, at least in some members of the pinniped family, there's a small amount of echolocation that they do. It's not as sophisticated as the kind of echolocation that happens in dolphins, but there is basic echolocation in some pinnipeds where they make a noise and they listen for how the echo comes back. Now, a dolphin does that. They can tell you everything about how their environment is around them. They can see stuff that's even hidden under sand and things like that. But basic studies have shown that sea lions probably do seem to have some ability to echolocate in a kind of a basic way, too. So, fascinating stuff, right? Now, we have just a couple more questions. Looks like Chris asked, oh, this is a good one, how big are seals? So, let's see here. Well, James was kind enough to write down the exact numbers here, so I don't have to try to pull them from memory. You can see some of our husbandry staff measuring one of our harbor seals here. So, the biggest seal is the elephant seal, which I've been talking about a lot. The elephant seal gets to 5 to 8,000 pounds for the males. The females can get up to about 5,000 pounds. And the males can be up to 12 feet long. Another example is the Lake Baikal seal. Lake Baikal is in Russia. And this one gets from about... James, is this the smallest seal? The smallest seal. I just discovered this seal existed just now, by the way. I've never heard of this one before. The Lake Baikal seal gets about 3 to 5.5 feet long and comes in at about 140 to 300 pounds, with the average being about 150 pounds, about 4 feet. So that's still a pretty big animal, right? And that's the smallest member of the entire seal family. And then finally, we've got one more question. This will have to be our last. How did you get your seals and sea lions? Good question. So the seals and sea lions at the aquarium mostly come from other aquariums and zoos and institutions like that. We don't do rescue things with seals and sea lions because, frankly, there's a lot of them in the ocean. And when we have marine mammal rescues for seals and sea lions, we generally are pretty good at re-releasing them into the ocean. But there are some seals and sea lions that are still born in human care, and those will and I believe all of those that we currently have at the aquarium came through that means. That being said, marine mammals do sometimes get rescued and end up living at zoos and aquariums. And this is especially the case with some of the more endangered or rare ones. For example, sea otters are an animal that if you see them at any aquarium in North America, they came from a rescue. We don't have them born in human care. There's plenty of them that need rescuing. And also, if you see things like walruses in aquariums and zoos, they are often rescue animals as well, though it's very rare to find an aquarium or zoo that has a walrus. So thank you so much for joining us today. It's been a pleasure taking all these questions, and I'm sure you've got lots more. So James will be answering questions for a few more minutes on our text stream. If you want to join us again, we do have one more class coming up at 2 o'clock. That'll be the, what's that one called? Tide Pool Habitats. And that's a really cool one for everybody, really. There's all sorts of cool stuff we can talk about in tide pools. So if you want to join us again, we'll be back in about 29 minutes. But thank you very much, everybody. It's been a pleasure talking about seals and sea lions and their conservation today. My name is Luke from the Aquarium of the Pacific, And I want you to have a great rest of your day. Bye-bye.